I'm Veena Gundavelli, and I'm leading the analytics efforts for Solix, and I'm also the CEO and founder for Imaja, a finance analytics company. We have an exciting 1 hour plan for you on analytics, and I have here with me two distinguished speakers. One, Sudhakar Muddu. He's the Vice President and General Manager of Splunk. And Joydeep Das, he's the Chief Operating Officer of KloudData. Both of these gentlemen are experts in the analytics space and have applied analytics in a number of different applications. We are here going to share with you, one, analytics, what are the general trends and challenges out there, and what is Solix's direction in the analytics space. And following that, between all three of us, we'll share with you some enterprise applications where you can use analytics and how these analytics can drive value out of the data. Again, you have seen from the last two tasks, last two sessions, the entire focus is around how do you take data and how do you turn that into value. And one of the things that I like to highlight is I know a lot of IT departments are out there gathering data into the big data systems. There are a lot of there's a lot of talk about how do you ingest data, how do you manage the data, and how do you govern the data, and companies right now need to get focused on how can they consume that particular data. And the analogy is having a lot of oil sitting out there, in the barrels. And if you don't have, an engine, a car, or a vehicle, or a truck, or a plane, to take it and consume that, then you're not going to get anywhere. So smart companies, have already figured out how do you take massive amounts of data, how do you store them, how do you process them, and how do you use them on a day-to-day basis within your enterprise. And you've seen, again, examples over and over again with Netflix, with Uber, and several other companies. They've displaced, they've disrupted industries, and they have displaced their competition and emerged on the top. So today, my message is primarily to the IT departments and the business leaders of the enterprise. What are you doing with the big data? Again, 40% of them do not know how to derive value out of big data, and another 40% don't have plans on big data. So hopefully in the next 1 hour, we'll highlight what are the different ways you can derive value out of the data. And the key message is, if you're not thinking about that, then you are not doing justice, to your organization. You're probably going to end up, like a person on a freeway with a lot of fast-moving cars, going all around you. So again, with that, let's focus on what is the current challenge right now. In a lot of big data environments, data is coming from multiple different systems. Again, there is operational data, there is archive data. And how do you take that particular data? What is the single value of truth? How can I trust that particular data? How can I turn that into analytics? That seems to be still in a lot of challenge. On the other hand, data science is also another big topic. Where IT departments have, in their early stages to understand, why data science and why do we need that, need to get them to the enterprise. We talked to a lot of business leaders, like CFOs, for example, or CMOs. A lot of them are still trying to understand, I know we have a lot of this data, but we don't know how do we put these projects together and how do you turn them into the value. That seems to be, again, a lot of today's discussion, as well as we see that a lot happening with the companies. And the good aspect of again all of this discussion, you've already seen with the talk with Scott from Hortonworks and KloudData and other people, that the big data community is responding this in a very fast order. And there's a lot of discussion around how do you empower business processes. How do you create a data to be a single source of truth? And you know, what's the best way to govern that? You know, there's a talk about having you know, like a data fabric or a data marketplace available for companies to be able to consume that particular data. Ways to analyze data are getting better and better. You're already seeing with Spark and other systems where in-memory computation is becoming a lot more simpler. And that's where, a lot of value can be derived from that. Machine learning is one of the top strategic trend in the industry these days. Every big data application or analytics application is actually looking at, how do you take machine learning and put, cognitive, learning capabilities, within your application. So the list goes on and on. But the key thing I like to highlight is, as we move forward, again, analytics are going to be in each and every business applications out there. And this is where, from a Solix point of view, we are making big big efforts in our R&D to take ourselves to the next stage. We want Solix big data solution or this system to be one platform where you will be able to get the data from multiple different places and provide that fabric of the single source of truth for the business applications, as well as provide a lot of data preparation, data analysis, kind of capabilities available to the end applications as APIs. And that is the big direction that we are taking. And we are building the Solix analyst workbench to incorporate a lot of those aspects where it is going to be a lot more simpler for applications to consume big data applications, big data. Again, if you look at most of the IT departments, does every IT department now need to, have a data science team, for example? Or, do you need to start worrying about, what are the most latest learning, techniques? Or, what's artificial intelligence? What is BI and other aspects? Do you need to worry about that? Or can you consume it, right out of the applications? Or, can you have best of breed vendors, create applications for you that can have analytics inbuilt or embedded into them and attach that right on top of the Solix Big Data platform. So that's our direction, and we have started out with, putting some of the partner solutions on top of the Solix Big Data platform. And such solution, I'll go into a lot more detail. But our idea is, again, with this, analyst workbench, we want to get applications, for finance, applications for marketing, applications for human resources, sales, operations, supply chain, and all aspects of the enterprise, to sit on top of the Solix Big Data platform. That's our big vision, and that's where we are heading towards. Again, the opportunity is enormous, and if you look at, this is one of the quotes from International Institute of Analytics. Big data analytics will be embedded everywhere across all enterprises, and the productivity gains that will bring that will be brought to the companies will be over $430 billion. So if your enterprise and if your business leader is looking for where can we leverage big data and how can we leverage analytics application, it's time for them to start looking for putting analytical applications into their businesses. I'll give you an example of one such application. Again, Imaja, we are a finance analytics company primarily focused around finance shared services centers. Our primary goal is to help finance shared services be more efficient, more faster, more smarter, and derive not only cost of operations down for the companies, but improve cash flows, improve profitability, and all of those nice aspects. So I'll give you a simple case study as to how we use analytics for finance shared service centers. Typical goal, again, for large shared service centers, you have data coming from disparate systems, typically 20, 30, or sometimes 100, 150 disparate systems, financial systems all around the globe. You have the finance teams sitting all around the globe. And for a CFO or a treasurer, you know, for them to, you know, have a corporate objectives and run these objectives, you know, through, you know, this, you know, set of, you know, both systems, processes, as well as, you know, all of these set of peoples, it's very hard, if, you know, to drive almost a real-time, you know, process changes, or even to impact on a weekly basis or a monthly basis. In most cases, you know, people use Excel spreadsheets, you know, that are actually very reactive, and you know, they get the information at a, you know, at a very later stage. So what we do here is we have embedded analytics, you know, right into our core application, which financial state service centers can use. Let me give you an example. So first and foremost, we gather all of the, you know, financial data into a single system, and from there, you know, we monitor, you know, as an example, you know, customer payment behavior. If a customer, again, we take a customer payment behavior across a number of different attributes. One, you know, take a lot of historical data of your interactions with the company, with the customer. You know, how did this customer, you know, pay you? Whether did this person pay you on time? Which product lines are they using? You know, is there a difference between their payment behavior across one product line or a different product line or a different region? Maybe their Asia division is paying a lot more slower than the, you know, and the North American counterpart. And also, we take a lot of external data. We take Dun & Bradstreet, for example, or Credit Bureau, and a number of different other data. We couple all of that data. We, you know, again, you know, put together, you know, an entire, you know, customer payment model, and monitor their behavior. And based on that particular behavior, again, we micro segment what is, you know, the decision that we need to give to a particular customer on a particular transaction. And based on that, we recommend how that particular transaction needs to be treated. For example, if it is a low-risk customer, you know, maybe I need to, you know, send some, you know, letters more often, and maybe, you know, have a call center person, you know, give a, you know, give a call. Maybe I need to have a high-touch approach on that particular account, for example. Or if I have, you know, an on-time paying customer, maybe I don't even need to call up that customer. Maybe I don't even need, you know, my resources in the finance department to even spend any time on that. So we do a lot of that analysis, and in turn, when we drive these personalized actions, you know, to the finance department, the receivables operations department, what happens with that is, one, the efficiency of the finance department increases. Two, you may not need as many people as you may have in your back office. And three, you can have a better, you know, customer satisfaction or experience. So these are all some of the things. But the most tangible thing that actually comes out of all of this is, you know, improved cash flow. Here, you know, sitting out as a CFO and the Treasury Department, they can have a lot more control and better accuracy to project what is my weekly cash flow going to be, and, you know, how can I derive that value? This is a case study of, you know, $3 billion company, a Siemens Group company that we have implemented across the world, and we have improved the average days of pay for each customer from 86 days to 65 days. And just that impact, that few days of impact, created about, you know, close to $30 million of additional cash flow every month. And that is significant. We talk about driving value from data. This is a very clear example of how you can take data, put it into actions, and derive value. Again, our approach to financial shared services using Solix Big Data platform. We use the underlying platform both for the archiving and the data lake, and we run our applications on top of that, you know, our very specific point applications which the finance departments use. For example, you know, credit management, you know, when they're granting credit, or collections management, deductions management, all of those aspects. We not only give those, you know, day-to-day operational functions, but we also give a lot of prescriptive, descriptive, as well as predictive analytics for finance departments to be able to see what is their general direction, where are they going, and, you know, how are they moving forward. So, you know, again, there's a lot of opportunities, you know, how you can take data and, you know, turn that into value. This morning, you know, somebody talked about, you know, how do we take the data-driven opportunity. It is all about making decisions in real time. It's all about, you know, personalizing a decision. And, you know, if you are able to embed analytics into your day-to-day business process, this is what you can do. And another, interesting one that we are trying to do is, taking this real time, not only just on dashboards on the screen, we are trying to take this right to the CFO. And let me give you an example of what we're doing on that. And I'll quickly switch over to a different screen for that. Very quick demonstration. Alexa, open dashboard.
Welcome to Imagia Analytics Dashboard.
Show summary.
Here is the global summary for Imagia Corporation. The total billing was $241 million, with outstanding receivables at $72 million. Total disputed amount is $56,000. We have sent 2,852 dunning letters. There are 34 agents actively working.
Show weekly cash flow.
Here is the weekly cash flow projections.
So we have got this small presentation for you. So our goal is to take this information more and more from the big data stores into the operationals and into the business leaders.
Here is the weekly cash flow projections.
Alexa, stop.
Okay.
So with this, I like to, invite my next speaker here. Again, Sudhakar, Muddu, very accomplished, senior entrepreneur and serial entrepreneur and expert in the big data. He's going to share with us, how artificial intelligence and analytics, can impact your enterprise.
All right, so my presentation may be a little different than your so far what you've heard. I thought I'll make it a little provocative. So I can go through my slides, or you guys can ask me questions. So it's up to you how you want to do it in the next 20 minutes. So if I don't see any questions, I'll keep going on the slides. But if you want to ask a question, raise your hand, okay? Is that fair? So with that, let me just forward to the slides and show you what I'm thinking about to talk to you. I think you heard from a lot of good speakers today morning, very similar trends, but the difference that I'm going to talk probably is following. I think every business that when we go talk outside the enterprises, whether consumer or whether you talk about the large enterprises, I think every CEO, every business is going to reinvent their how their business operation is going to be in the next, whatever call it, 3 years, 5 years, primarily because of two, three trends, right? The cloud is a major, is a disruptive trend. Analytics, big data is a big difference. Then you have AI and machine learning. So combined together, how do you going to disrupt your business models and the revenue growth? That hasn't happened today. So what we have seen so far on the big data, most of this is cutting the operations, trying to cut down, how can I do efficiently? How can I improve my productivity? I think we are in a totally different era so far, and there's a new era for the big data to really take off, has to help with generating the revenue. If you don't satisfy the revenue generation, these technologies won't really take off. And that's the premise of what I'm going to say today, right? So here is an example of what you can see, right? If you look at most of the technologies, people have spent time in improving their operations, whether it's IT operations, whether it is they're improving their security operations, maybe they're trying to store the data, going from EDW to Hadoop technologies. I think all of them, is, I call it the table stakes, right? That really does not happen. So if you go to the CEO of a large corporate and say, look, I have done this thing, I cut your cost by 1 million, 2 million. It matters to him. But really, does he care? If you go to him and say, look, where should you sell your next product? Where should I open my offices? How should I do the new markets? What new other SKUs can I offer? That's what they want to hear. Because the real trends that are happening out there is people are being disrupted because new business models are emerging. So unless you can solve that, I think that the current way of thinking will not work. So people are really focused on operations trend, and the only way that will happen is if somebody were to think about new markets, disrupting the existing players. Look at, if Uber were not to go and disrupt the taxi industry, it wouldn't have happened. Same thing, Google went and said they disrupted the ad tech industry. So the question too is, whatever the consumer technologies have done is to generate new revenue models and new business models. However, when we enter the enterprises, we talk a lot about productivity, operations, data. I don't think the C-level guys really care about that. They just want to build applications, or they want to run their businesses. They just want to grow their revenue. Revenues are not growing for in the large enterprises today. So how do you grow the revenue is the key message that I want to talk about. Right? Here's an example. We went through what I call the digital marketing era for last 5-10 years. And now people say we are in a digitization of the business, right? Most businesses are going through digitization. Is that enough? I think if you look at the next 5 to 10 years, I don't have an answer as to whether it'll happen 5 years or 10 years, but we will eventually move into what I call autonomous businesses, or self-enforcing businesses, right? If AI and machine learning really happens, nobody knows what'll happen or not. It looks promising. So what it means is the businesses will tend to be going towards this direction. That means what? The call centers will be disrupted. Like she already showed the ecosystem, Amazon Echo or Alexa, right? You won't have people sitting there making phone calls and trying to say which ticket item will be there. That industry will be assimilated. So all the Indian outsourcing companies, any call center, if I were to bet, I'm going to go short on them because of Amazon Alexa. Because I don't need that. Look at what ServiceNow is going to do in this space with Alexa. Right? So the key for you is to think about how can you disrupt new business models? And that won't happen by doing better and more equal on the cost perspective. That means you need to move into these columns, the autonomous columns or the self-enforcing column, etc. And by the way, that's what Gartner is talking about. Then if you look at the really, take two industries, two verticals, financials, banking and insurance. If you talk to the people, what is really creating value-wise, revenue-wise? They only focus on revenue. Financial industry is not going there. You talk to the Capital One CEO, you talk to the Goldman Sachs CEO, what does he want? He's saying the software is eating their business, the fintech space. He wants everybody out there, employees, to figure out how to generate new revenue models. How can you do options trading better? How can you do wealth management better? Not with people. The number of banking agents, the tellers will be gone, the traders will be gone. So in a way, what's going to happen is these things is going to disrupt the jobs. But there'll be new jobs will come. Or may not be. That's a different question. Is this going to drive where the jobs will go away and new jobs will come or not? Nobody knows the answer yet. Right? But the question is, focus on the revenue is the key message here. Now, if you're doing that, there are 2-3 changes that need to happen there. I think last 15-20 years, what we went through is everything to a single product and application. Right? CRM is an application. Salesforce is an application. ERP is an application. Everything is, now I think, if you now think through what's going to happen next 10 years, what I'm hearing from customers, everybody wants to be a platform business. Amazon is a platform. Azure wants to be a platform. Google wants to be a platform. Oracle is a platform. I mean, how many platforms can you build on your applications? And if you go to the developers, can they write all of them? How can you train your developers to know .NET and Java Spring, and you want to go to train them on Amazon and Google? It's not going to happen. But the world wants, the customers want to create their own platforms. Goldman has their own platform to build it on top of them. They employ more software developers than any software company in the valley, enterprise company. This is just one company, Goldman Sachs alone. Right? Look at the number of developers work at Goldman Sachs and look at any software company, enterprise company in the valley. They have more developers. Question is, what is this platform going to be? Who is going to develop them? And what is going to be the currency of those? It's not at the level of the data level. Earlier I heard about some questions about data, unstructured. People don't talk about that when I'm out there. They don't give a damn about that. Whether you do ETL, data masking, they were saying, go hub, you solve it, you figure it out. If Alexa can talk about all those things, why can't Alexa also do, tell me what the attributes are? They don't want to talk about integer, float, what maps and arrays, etc. That's already a solved problem. Apply machine learning, apply AI, or apply analytics to figure that out. Right? That's the type of platforms people are looking for. Now, if you look at the Gartner's Magic Quadrant app platforms, look at it, it's pretty crowded. At one point, it should be one or two platforms, right? Look at how many, Salesforce wants to be a platform with Force.com and Heroku, Microsoft is a platform, right? IBM wants to be a platform. So the question is, this platform is where you are going to run your entire businesses, entire corporations. GE wants to be a platform too, right? GE is doing a Predix. It's not saying I'm a solution, you take it there. They're saying that, take me and build your application on it. Build your entire business on it. GE is not doing for GE itself. It's asking Bosch, it's asking Siemens, it's asking Raytheon, everybody to use this type of platforms, right? Then if you look at what's happening with the cloud vendors, right? Do you think Amazon is an infrastructure vendor? No way. I mean, talk to any developers who are there, they're going to say Amazon is a PaaS layer. Amazon is the next platform. They're slowly sucking people in to build it on top of them. Once you're building into that, it's a vendor lock-in. Are you going to replace their Elastic Load Balancer? Are you going to replace their Kinesis service? Their Lambda services? No way. Once you build it there, they know that you're going to stick with them. As applications have a gravity, data is a gravity, and all of the above. question is the new emerging players are, they are the cloud vendors becoming a development platform as well as execution platforms. They're not just trying to give you pure compute, network, and storage. That year is over. That's 10 years back. So in these new platforms, how are you going to exist? Is it going to help you either to build the application fast enough? What is the metrics that customers want? If you talk to the CEO, I want a fast time to market. I want to use less resources, less dollars. When I talk to any customer out there, the application to build on any of these platforms, today is very expensive. Most guys will say they're spending $50 to $100 million before the application goes to production. It's too hard to build an application right now on any platform. Somebody got to disrupt that. That's a great opportunity for everybody in this room to think of. Like so earlier, I think Scott was mentioning, right? He's talking about the animals in the zoo. The problem that I have is these animals are outside the cage. Coordinating them to make a music out of that is impossible. That's the whole Hadoop and Hadoop system or whatever Hadoop ecosystem is not happening. Customers are struggling a lot with Hadoop ecosystem. I mean, it'll take 100, 200 people for 2 years to build an application. Is that easy? That means there's a value for somebody to take these, call it platforms, or take these animals and try to create a music out of that, so that it'll take only 10 people to build an application. Nobody has figured it out. I mean, how many people are going to take, how many venture dollars or corporate dollars to build an application? It's not easy. So that's where these guys come in, right? Here's an example of what I was talking about. Amazon is a PaaS. Amazon is not an infrastructure service. And not just Amazon, it's talk about Oracle, it's Google, all of the above. Right? Now let's look at what the apps are, right? At the end of the day, the platforms are meant to build applications, whether it's simply in the fintech business or insurance business or healthcare business or whichever the business that you want to build. You want to build this application. But the question is, to build this application, you want to have fewer resources, fewer dollars, and fewer number of time to market, time it takes to do it. If you can enable that, all these guys will be your customers. Here's an example of what Gartner talks about. What's really, if you look at it, analytics, to all these technologies are there, but none of them are really building a platform. Is the BI really a platform? I don't think so. BI is a visualization engine. Is ERP a point solution? Can I build an application around ERP? Probably not. Now, the question is, how can you take all these discrete pieces of technology and create something, a platform where the developers can do something magic? That hasn't happened yet. Right? Here is an example of what the big data players are right now. I think this report is from Wikibon guys. Look at the players are. I mean, this is the product, software product revenues in the big data space, right? And they're not much. I mean, they're decent. There's good enough revenues out here. But let me show you the next slide where the monies are. Look at this revenue. So the actual money right now in big data is in the services industry. The service industry are your IBMs, Accentures. Why? Why services guys are making more money here than the product guys? Because today the products, technologies are not products yet. So today if you want to do it, you're going to call Accenture, Deloitte, PwC. Everything is a service, everything is a solution. It's too hard, too complex. That means, whenever you see money on the services guys, there's an opportunity for a product company out there to create a shrink wrap product that you can sell it as a platform. Take the money off of these guys. Money should go from here to the product vendors. It's a great opportunity. There's more money on the services than the product vendors today. Right? Then let's look at all the top 10 technologies by any, pick your own top 10 from Gartner, Forrester, whoever. It'll be some combination of these or something new. But the question is, how can you now integrate all these things? How can you put data quality to data integration? Data is too hard. You're going to use ETL, Informatica, and all these things and do it by yourself? It's too hard. How can you integrate all of them all the way to come to the decision making? People want to make a decision. All he wants is, when he gets up, is my operations doing well? Where am I losing money? What revenue I should go? What show should I shut down? Where should I, my salespeople? That's what CEOs want. CEOs don't want to talk about technologies. But that discussion is not happening. It's too hard. If you go with that to any analytics guy, he'll say, I'll come back with a predictive answer after 2 years. He's going to get fired. Right? CEOs don't have it. The role of a chief data officer is not happening fast enough because the data officer cannot answer anything today. He has his title, he has all these technologies. But he cannot tell where should I open an office or not today. It's too hard. Why? Ask that question. Until we solve that problem, this whole technology really does not help the businesses. And look at what areas, this is my prediction of what one. I think all these other vendors, like either vendors or technologies or markets, like take data discovery vendors, or specialized databases like metrics databases or time series databases, or take the pure ETL integration vendors, or message and communication engineers. They're all small pieces of tools. They're not companies, they're not even products. To me, those are features. How many can I integrate? How many can I do it? So I think all these things will get consolidated. It may happen 1 year, 2 years, or 5 years. I bet at some point, 5 to 10 years from now, you'll see all this will be part of the bigger platforms. In a way, it'll be nice available APIs, libraries, SDKs that developers can link, compile, use it easily. And that's what exactly happened, why Java was got created. From Java, that's what happened with BA WebLogic, WebSphere. That's how Spring Source happened. And that's how Paul Maurice bought Spring Source, that became Cloud Foundry and Pivotal. So I think at every 5 years, 10 years, they go through generational change where you see all these technologies and somebody got to manage them and give them into a simple form for developers to use. Today, we are not empowering the developers. Until developers can use it, they cannot create magic. Until they create magic, businesses cannot grow. So it's all a connected problem to me, in a way. Right? Look at this landscape, a big data landscape. I mean, it's increasing. I can't even read the names on these charts anymore. It won't be like this in 10 years from now. I mean, it will be gone. There'll be earthquakes, craters, call it whatever it is. This whole area is going to get mangled up into some few vendors is going to remain. It's too hard to have so many spaces here. Now, with this, other change that's happening is, cloud is not the next generation computing cycle. In my view, we went through mainframe, we went through client server. Cloud is 2006, it started by Amazon. Today is 2016, it's a 10 years old technology. So the next way will be, call it whatever you call it. Call it cognitive computing, call it AI. I mean, some name is going to happen next year, next 10 years. That's the age we are in. Now, what is that age going to be look like in 2026? That's what we should think about to solve the problems on. So here is an example of the same disruption. So focus on what will be 5 years from now, or 10 years from now. I think the cloud and all of them, we're all done with cloud. Look at where the puck is going to move to solve these applications and businesses, right? So if you believe in that fourth generation computing cycle and what it will solve, so I think my prediction is AI and machine learning is going to do it. Now, question I would ask, why? Why is AI and machine learning so important now than 40 years back Alan Turing invented it? What's new, right? Let's ask ourselves that questions, right? One thing fundamentally new that happened in 2016, if you guys followed sometime it happened in January or February, Google did this Go game. Did you guys follow that with South Korean champion? What is new out of those? The program itself wrote dynamically a new source code. So far programs have been, data science have been written by data scientists. What the Go did in 2016 is, the actual sequence of the code is written by the algorithm itself. So I don't need data scientists. So I'm ready to fire data scientists if I can do that. Right, that's a new age. The new age, so 2016 will go in history of computing as the first time a code was written and executed and won successfully in scoring and recommendation against some other human being. That hasn't been done before. Imagine the possibilities it can do, right? It's not like executing a executable code. It's writing a source code, compiling it, and pushing it to a machine, and then executing them. That hasn't happened. So study this thing, what they have done. And see if you can apply that to your industries. That is going to drive a lot of change. Right? So if you look at, I call that algorithmic businesses. Right? If you talk to the CEO of Capital One or Don Dewitt at Goldman Sachs, all these guys wouldn't tell you, or Guy Shiller at First Data, they're all saying every business is going to become algorithmic business. Forget about digital business, that's done 10 years back now. What does it mean, algorithm business? So machines are going to answer for many things that we cannot do it as human being. I don't want to have a product manager anymore. I want the data to be my product manager. Product managers will become project managers now. Right? If I am a CEO, I want to know what is data telling me automatically. What's the decision making I'm supposed to do? I only want the decisions. I can overrule the decision, but I want to know what the decision is. Right? So that's where the world is going towards. And figure out what can be done in those technologies, right? Gartner is also saying something. They're saying at least 20% of business will become algorithmic businesses. That's a lot. 20% of tech, 100,000 companies, 500,000 companies, or Fortune 5,000 companies. It's a great opportunity for everybody. Assuming they're right, but here's another example that they talk about, what businesses are going from digital business to autonomous to algorithm. So this world about algorithm business, whatever the name it's going to be, is to automation. It's the machines making the decisions without a human being. They'll be wrong, they'll be false positives, but they're going to learn faster than you and me can learn. All they have to do is beat an average person that I'm going to hire. If an algorithm can beat an average developer and data scientist in big data, why do I need a data architect? Why do you need a data scientist? An average kid coming out of a college, he now has to beat an algorithm before I give a job. That's a new age. That's how people are going to be interviewing in the future. So we give them a code and see if he can write a code to beat an algorithm. If algorithm writes a better code, why do I need a human being? I think there's a lot of experiments going on there. A lot of VCs are funding those projects. A lot of customers are doing that. So think that. Your competition is not the guy sitting next to you, right or left. Your competition is the algorithm that is running somewhere in the cloud. That will take away your job. If you can beat it, you can monetize your career or monetize your business. So here's the other point that I want to make. In terms of what is driving machine learning, it is the need for automation is what we are doing today. The future is enabling a new business model. If algorithms won't tell me how to make revenue, I'm going to fire the algorithm, right? So people are going to deploy algorithms only to find out where the revenue and this is going to happen. Other few questions, I'm going to go fast for the lack of time. Either ask yourself, most of these are common questions. All of you are brilliant people, figure it out. What is the reason for AI machine learning happening? Why is it hard? What are the real examples? What are the use cases? What can I do with it? Ask the fundamental questions. What can be done with it? What cannot be done with it? Some can be done today, some because of technology you can do it 2 years from now. Right? I think there's a need for a scalable machine learning platform. People talk about algorithms and models, but where am I going to run this model? Is model a Java code? Is it a Python, Node.js? Is it an executable? Where do I run it? Is there a platform to run it? If I run it, can I parallelize them? What is cloud has done, either VMware, Amazon, is now we take these algorithms, we can parallelize them. If somebody writes a code, it's not parallelizable, it's no good for me. I want a platform which can either parallelize it. If it cannot, I can go back to the algorithm and say, parallelize the algorithm. But finding an algorithms and platforms to run it is a key point. So from that, I think I already covered. I actually talk in the world of, there is a two type of apps, thin apps and thick apps, and how can they become what I call time to market, etc. So other last point I want to make is, if you look at the how things have done for last, whatever, 10, 15, 20 years, we started with the rule systems, we went to analytics, KPI, and dashboards. That's how today we work. Future, that will be, everything will be autonomous decision making. Nobody that I talk to want to see any waveforms. Nobody even want to see a KPI. KPI is something you created it. We want system to tell the KPIs and correlations. Why should you determine the KPI that my revenue correlated with time is important? Maybe something else is important. System should find this relationship. I fundamentally believe that if you write a right algorithm, system can do better job than any human being can, except few people. Right? So to that extent, look at it, what the people are asking. Each of you guys are of kids and families and friends. If you look at all the kids that I talk to who are in the IT and enterprise, they all grew up in the age of Apple, Netflix, and Uber. They're all decision-making system. There's no waveform, there's an IT showing you signals, KPI. So IT wants this. CEOs want this type of apps. Fully decision-making. They don't want to see waveforms and this thing and somebody to interpret it. There's a cultural shift happening there. So people who are going to buy your products are the people who grew up with this. And if you build a product for that, it's not going to happen. I think I'm going to stop there. I think I might have out of my time here. So thank you. That's it.
Hello, everyone. Welcome. So in this session, I will cover some aspects of healthcare and how big data analytics applies to healthcare. As you have heard, this is the age where analytical applications, especially in the context of big data, actually helps you put the right context into various business problems instead of being caught up in the noise of all of the background infrastructure. And that's what we are going to focus on right now. So a quick overview of my company, KloudData. So we focus on healthcare, manufacturing, high tech, and other verticals. Our focus is to build applications and bring the trust to our customers. And we are not focused on analytics or ERP. We combine ERP, analytics, and mobility and bring the UI, UX to contextualize complex workflows in these industries. So that's what we do. With that out of the way, let me just quickly give an example of what we're going to cover here, talk about the competitive advantage in the vertical industries, and speak specifically in the context of healthcare. I'll talk about our framework that we use in the context of healthcare, and give you some specific examples of big data applications that we are working on. So, you may have seen some aspects of big data applications, but let me just bring it and make it more real for you. For example, in retail, in Walmart, they're actually doing a lot of textual and semantic search and text analytics to figure out how to convert all the clickstream data, that means users who come to walmart.com, and convert them into actually purchasing customers instead of just coming and showing interest, how to convert them. So they are using a lot of complex clickstream analysis in the context of big data, bringing it all into a large platform, analyzing it, and helping them convert all these users into actual buyers. And they have improved that by 10 to 15%. Gives an example of where you're cutting out all of the background noise of big data, and you're only focusing on what you really want to convert, which is the ROI for this business. American Express, they are able to use complex math models to study every cardholder's behavior and put that in the context of big data and figure out who's going to churn and look at that loyalty. They're even able to predict up to 24% of their customers are going to churn over the next 4 months. They're able to get to that level of detail with the math model that they're building. It's another example of how a vertical application is being used using big data without being concerned about what is happening in the background. In the pharma industry, Express Scripts is a big company, so they now have these vials and bottles that carry a prescription drugs that actually beep and glow when it's due for your medication. And people who need the medication the most are the ones who are least likely to take it in diabetes and, you know, blood pressure and so on and so forth. But it's not just the beeping and the glowing that matters. It what happens with that data that goes back in the back end and gets analyzed with refill data and everything else, and how that gets pushed out to the caregivers for further analysis on how to treat the patient and how to engage the patient better. So all of these things are also happening as intelligent applications of big data. Another example is in insurance. Infinity actually uses the concept of dark data. Some of the presentations earlier talked about 80% of the data is inactive, it's not used. That's actually dark data. Dark data is nothing but the data that is lying there in repositories, but actually not being looked at. They are being thought of as inactive data and not so important. Fortunately for a lot of analytical companies and applications, dark data is important. And you talked about archiving in the Solix platform, all of that data eventually becomes very, very useful. And looking at them very deeply with multiple variables and coming out with insights is extremely critical. So in this case, Infinity actually was able to find fraud from all of that dark data, and they got back $12 million with their very first initiative. And imagine what this means once they expand it beyond just home insurance, and they did it only for home insurance so far. Now, coming to healthcare industry. So those gave you an example of vertical applications that are repeatable. It's not a one-time thing. So as soon as a use case becomes repeatable, it becomes interesting, because then you bring and build pre-built applications to that problem that's done again and again and again, just like ERP did it, CRM did it, and every other application did it. In this case, it's big data applications. In the context of what was just mentioned by Muddu earlier about how these applications become intelligent, why should human beings do it? These applications should come up. He mentioned in the context of algorithms, but those algorithms get subsumed in the context of an application. And so those examples were exactly what the industry is headed towards. Why have human beings do it when these things can do it for you? But let's come and focus more on healthcare, because that's where my company is focused on as an industry. And there are lots of disruptive changes happening in healthcare industry itself. First of all, we have this clear separation in the United States between insurance companies and the hospitals, or the payers and the providers. But with Obamacare and a lot of these other regulations come in, it's more interesting for these to be one organization, like Kaiser, right? It's a payer and a provider. So a lot of these ACOs are being formed where interesting data can be exchanged and analyzed, and that's the context. The other is meaningful use, which is essentially you have this EMR and EHR systems from which data has to be brought out and followed and analyzed in the context of regulations. And the quality of care improves. It's not just how many patients do you see, it's how many patients have you seen with the right outcome. That's what is important here. The next is population health. If you have a group of people and how do you manage their disease, whether it's diabetes or what have you, for that population, how do you get to better healthcare and better outcome? Especially when you know that particular subsegment of the population is at risk. The other aspect is once a patient leaves the four walls of a hospital, the hospital's pretty much lost the patient in terms of caregiving. So how do you manage that continuous care? Once the patient's left the hospital, how do you make sure that they're taking their medication, that they're taking, doing the right kind of exercises, they're following the diet regimen that they have been advised? Because you don't have the nurse and the caregiver at that hospital, at that person's home. How do you do that? So that's an interesting problem that's coming up. And then finally, healthcare costs are going up dramatically. How do you manage the resources, whether it's actual physical resources that you track through RFID and asset traceability, or the beds that have been allocated to a patient, different kinds of beds, ICU bed, general ward beds, how do you allocate the nurses and doctors around it to solve that optimization problem? So all of these are very interesting challenges in the healthcare industry that has come up now that is begging for analytics. And the way they have to be solved is not just through human interaction, it's just way too complicated for human beings to solve it. It requires analytics. And not just analytics, but analytics that is multi-form with all this volume, velocity, variety that we heard earlier this morning. So at KloudData, the way we look at it is that it's a multi-source variety, volume, and all of that you heard about actually comes together in the context of a healthcare. I don't want to bore you with details with technology here, but essentially it starts with a back-end ERP system to EMR systems like Epic, to patient management and clinical systems that gets transaction processing done on a day-to-day basis. But all of that data has to make it for analytics to happen on them so that you can make proper decisions, whether it's a traditional KPI-based analytics, as was pointed out, that even those KPIs should be self-generated, but having known some of those KPIs, how they're automated in terms of the way they're presented, and discovery of more information in terms of correlations through predictive and big data, but also connected to mobility at the point of care, patient engagement. Mobility is a big part of this whole concept because it's not just sitting at your desk, it's as you're moving around and being able to do that. And mobility, not just in terms of apps. We are so used to apps that it's become an overkill. Just too many apps, how many apps do you want to deal with? So now it's not just that, one is Alexa, you saw an example. Another example is chatbots. So you have bots, and instead of an app, all you have is a bot. It's so natural as a human being to communicate with each other with text messages. So why not communicate with the machine with a text message? And just ask your questions with the chatbot, and behind the scenes, all of these things get done. So our belief at KloudData is to build these kinds of systems that are plug and play. As the new technologies evolve and come in, we have the right plug at the right use case level. And there are a whole bunch of things that we have to take care of, not to bore you with details there, but all of those things are thought through. So let me focus on four key use cases in healthcare that we see on a day-to-day basis. We work mainly in the United States and in Asia Pacific, and we see hospitals of all kinds, some that are greenfields, starting from scratch, and everything is 21st century medicine, to others which are 20th century medicine, trying to transform into 21st century medicine, where this plug and play comes in, right? So the four areas that I would like to bring your attention to is how to look at utilization of assets like a hospital bed through length of stay prediction. How long will the patient stay there? What is the complications if the patient stay too short or too long. And then we have a few others. We'll go through them one by one. Let's start with length of stay. So if you have a patient staying in the hospital for too long, then you can have an issue with costs. If it's too short, the risk that the patient will get readmitted. And based on that, you have to allocate the right amount of staffing of nurses and doctors. If you have overstaffing, it's too expensive. If you have understaffing, you are putting the patient and patient experience at risk. So it's an interesting problem to solve. And there are lots of input data that has to be looked at, from complex data sets to variables, lots of tools that come into the situation, and even the models have to evolve. You may have taken all the disease codes into account, suddenly you have Zika virus. What do? You don't have that in your disease code. So you have to deal with this model evolution as well. And then very, very large data sets where big data comes in. So this is an example of actual screenshots of our application where you're predicting how long a patient will stay based on various parameters, whether it is diagnosis or exactly the week of day the bed will be occupied, and how many patients are flowing in through ER department, through regular doctor referral, or any other source that may come in. The other example is population health, where you're looking at the community crisis, healthcare costs, patient experience, and how this patient is going to self-manage. And you come up with various aspects. So we solved a problem in a Midwest state where they were looking at child mortality rate, which was very, very bad in that particular state. And the governor's office wanted to combine a multitude of factors to see how they can solve that problem. And so they wanted recommendations of the factors that they should focus on to solve the infant mortality rate. And we built these models to actually help them deal with that through complex graph and predictive analytics. And another example is asset utilization. You have assets within a hospital tracked through RFID, and how they go through, whether they go from OT to sterilization, alarm goes off, or they get utilized in the right way, all of that has to be tracked through RFID and analyzed. And when they get analyzed, you don't just have business rules that you're aware of, but you discover new capabilities that can be pushed into that. And finally, with patient engagement, as I mentioned, as a patient leaves the hospital and goes home, how do you engage that patient? How do you analyze their behavior? So all of that through mobility applications, the data is fed back and forth through surveys, through questions, through their timing, and all of that is analyzed so that you come up with the right kind of recommendations and alerts, and you're able to tell the stakeholders. So the kind of architecture we are using is, a mixture of multiple technologies, and some technologies are mentioned here, like Solix is a big area that we are focusing on. We're also looking at predictive modeling markup language as a standard way of doing it through Zementis, and asset traceability through Omnitrol. So multitude of technologies that we are bringing together to solve these problems, but the prescription is that the similar workflow applies to all of them as they come from EMR and other systems. And finally, it's not just the technology, but also the process and the people. How do we do what was mentioned earlier, where you take human beings away from the equation as much as possible? We are biased. We tend to make decisions which are often emotional. How do you take that out from the discovery of data to basically preparing data to building the models? But at some point, we do need subject matter experts or SMEs to take a look at it, especially in the case of healthcare. A doctor looks at it and does give his opinion. He may not just accept it as is. But even that can be put in as expert system over time and solved. And so that's the other thing that we're using in our tool sets. We are trying to build all of these automation to take care of all of these capabilities. So with that, I'll stop here. Hopefully, it gave you a quick view of how vertical applications are taking over the concepts of value creation with big data being behind the scenes, and this application is the one that you're facing, and all you're interested in is the specific domain problems. In our case, we are solving a lot of these healthcare problems, starting from population health to asset traceability, as well as looking at how to optimize the utilization of resources. So hopefully this gives you a good picture of the kind of things that are possible. Okay, I'll stop. Yes.
This was developed for
hospitals, yes.
So it is biased.
It is developed for them, and that's why the point is that all the data that has come in, nobody has said that you have to use this data or that data. It's combining all of their data and coming up with recommendations that are interesting to the hospital's business problems.
Yeah, in the sense it is purely for making profit for the hospital, not for the patient.
No, patient engagement and experience is one big part of it. Yes, profit is a motive, absolutely, but that's biased in the sense that you're talking of from a business metric standpoint, but not all the problems. Yeah, we can have an interesting dialogue on that for sure.